Welcome back to Bread and Butter, everybody, where we are the Hearthstone podcast serving the basics for your Hearthstone improvement. Welcome to episode 30. I am Doc McButt, as always, joined by Tito Santana.
Hi, everybody.
And this week, we have not one, but two very special guests, Guy Grumpy and Noodle Swoop.
Howdy.
How are you both doing today?
I'm doing great.
Hello, I'm doing awesome.
Love to hear it. So, in honor of Happy Hearthstone hitting 250 very soon in the future, we're gonna hopefully share some things that bring us joy or make us happy. I'll start. I really enjoy hiking and spending time with the people I love, and my cat. My cat is just the fluffiest little boy that never shuts up. How about yourself, Tito?
Today was Father's Day for our listeners. We recorded on Sunday, and I have lots of joy for my son and my father, who I could see today. We drove down to Massachusetts, had some lunch, kind of unexpectedly. It was kind of a last-minute thing, and, you know, just happy for that. How about yourself, Mr. Guy? Guy Grumpy, how are you?
Oh, I'm doing fantastic, and, you know, I get to go first, which means that I get to be the one that says friendship, because Noodle Soup is actually joining me here. For this recording, he came up. I know that he was the first choice, but he drugged me along so that we could do this together as the Happy Hearthstone.
And how about yourself, Mr. Noodle Swoop?
So, definitely. The thing that's bringing me joy is the fact that this is the weekend that I get to actually meet Guy Grumpy in person. So that is exciting for me, and we've already had previously, then a couple nights prior, we've played games and hung out and just kind of relaxed and chilled. And it wasn't even specifically Hearthstone related. It was board games and shuffleboard and just kind of enjoying getting awesome. To know each other, which is awesome. Like to be able to kind of take down a little bit of like what we put out there for everybody to hear and see and kind of just be us, which was cool.
Copycat.
And for those that don't know, your Sharing Your Joys is a part of the Happy Hearthstone podcast, which is why we wanted to include it here. It's awesome that you guys are hanging together, especially since I said, hey, Noodle, you want to be on the show? He's like, sure. Can I go fly out to hang out with Guy Grumpy and we'll do it together? And I said, absolutely. That sounds fantastic. A little pricey. We can't afford to help pay for the flight or anything, but if that's what you want to do, great.
Wait. I thought that you were actually going to send you like the receipts for reimbursement.
Well, I appreciate that, and I will gladly take your receipts, but, you know, I won't do much with them. But what have you been doing? Well, I can't do anything with your receipts. Can you tell me what you've been doing in Hearthstone there, Noodle?
So in Hearthstone, I made a deck. Specifically a paladin deck that kind of took the ladder by storm. Pure Doomhammer Paladin is what I called it. And with the mini set, they released Horn of the Windlord. I was able to, you know, take my knowledge of paladin things because I'm a paladin main and put everything together into a deck that I promptly went to 55 Legend with. I posted my deck on Twitter. I also kind of pass it around to other content creators. And in fact, I have to give a shout out to Clark Hellscream. He put out a tweet for many different lists for the mini set. And in that, we saw tons of people retweeting, liking that specific post, my post as well. And kind of, as you know, it was so good that that Blizzard gave me the great birthday present of nerfing the deck as I'm on my little, you know, birthday vacation journey. And so it was so good that they said, here you go, here's a nice present for you. Not one, not two, but three cards that we're going to nerf for you. Although I'm still very much in high legend right now, so I'm still very happy with that. So that's what I'm doing in Hearthstone.
And how about yourself, Guy?
So I've kind of stretched a bit. So I've been really pushing on the collection front. Got my dust collection pretty extensive right now. With all those nerfs that just happened, I was able to craft another a mini set that you can't get in the wild packs. So getting a lot closer to that full golden collection. And then playing wise, I've been maining duels again, just because it's the easiest way for me to finish off quests and stay current. Just not at that 55 legend like my counterpart here.
Oh, so you're more in the top 20? I understand.
yeah, top diamond 20, right?
Doc, what about yourself? How have you been playing Hearthstone? What have you been playing?
Yeah, so I've played a little bit more Paladin, but I've been trying to hit 6,500 in BGs. I'm stuck between like 6,150 and like 6,350, and just bouncing up and down, not really making any progress, unfortunately. But it's been fun. I've been enjoying it, but it's just not been as successful as I wanted it to be. How about yourself, Tito?
Well, I actually got to Legend this month with Doomhammer Paladin. And this is how you know this is a good deck, because people are playing it. Normally, when Paladin's good, people still don't play it, and it doesn't matter. It has to be really broken good for people to play Paladin for some reason. And it's like 30% of the meta at one point, so or higher than that. It might have been like 32, 33. So you know it's a legit deck. And I have good news for you, Noodle. 40. That's even worse. But... I have good news for you. I'm sure you already know this. It's still good. It's still a very, very good deck. I've been bringing it to THL. I have not played it in THL because, of course, it's always getting banned. But that's fine. But, hey, Doc, what have you been doing outside of Hearthstone?
Yeah, so outside of Hearthstone, for those of that don't know, I work at a credit union. And so what the credit union I work for does every year is we have a summer social, which you get to choose like one of like four events that happen to go to with like your family and just meet other people at the credit union. And this year, it's my first year, but I chose to go to TuaCon, which is in the southern Utah area. It's a pretty prominent outdoor theater. It's also a theater high school, so parents will board their kids at this theater school. And the talent there is just super crazy. So we got to go see a live stage production with some pyrotechnics and some like screens. I forget what they call like that style of plays, but we got to see Tarzan, and it was so incredible. The actors were really good. The writing, they added songs that just didn't make a bunch of sense, but like, overall, it was really good. The performances were great. There was a few jokes that just didn't land, but they were still kind of funny. And they also had like this big old water like flood thing that happened at the beginning when Tarzan's parents get washed up on the coasts of Africa. And it was really cool. Like, they warned people in the front row, like, hey, like, don't put your stuff down until the flood's over because your stuff might get wet. And it's just outside surrounded by red sandstone. It started at like 8:40, and then we got home at like almost midnight because it was about 20-30 minute drive for us. But it's just, you're under the stars in like fairly nice weather watching a play. It was beautiful. It was awesome. Yeah, that's basically the cool stuff I want to share about what I've been doing outside of Hearthstone. Guy Grumpy, what about yourself?
I'll just have to say board games is where I've been kind of getting back into that. So my girlfriend and her brother and I are playing a Frosthaven campaign. It's a new legacy style, like dungeon crawler campaign. And then we just had in honor of Noodle coming up, we had a board game day here where some of my other streaming friends and some of Noodle's friends from the area all came up and played a few different worker placement games.
That's so awesome.
Nice to get back into that. I have a pretty hefty collection of board games as well. And they've been mostly collections, not played. So it's nice to get something to the table.
Heck yeah. What about yourself, Noodle?
So mine's more focused on friendship. Although we did play board games, I was able to hang out, as Guy kind of had a chance to let you know, hang out with friends as well. I kind of got to hang out with a new friend in person, finally, and also some old friends that I was catching up with from back before when I was in the military. Some of my friends have moved to this area, so it kind of worked out that I was able to hang out with multiple different friends. So that's just awesome for me. It's great to be able to catch up and then also kind of learn, hey, you know what, if I want to, it's always a fun place and a short trip to come up this way and come hang out and kind of do things, and it's cool.
Well, I'm going to say that it's kind of, I think, Guy, I think that you definitely never do anything half-assed when you collect things. You collect dust, you go full in, but you collect board games, you say you have a gigantic collection, you have streamer friends, you seem to have all of them. Like, so if Guy says, I'm going to start collecting something, watch out, because he's going to have to make some room, and he's going to do it all the way until he has it all. So that's awesome. It sounds like it's a lot of fun. Like I said, I haven't really been doing all that much. It's been it's kind of quiet as we're getting ready to go to Disney in a week. So I don't know if there'll be an episode next week or not. We're still planning on it, but it could get bumped depending because of my vacation. So sorry about that in advance. Doc also has a vacation coming up the week after. I'm assuming we're going to have episodes both weeks, but there's also a chance we might not have episodes either week. So we'll figure that out as we go. And apologies if it's a little hiatus, but it's not like we're going to go away anytime soon. But I did actually, so one interesting thing was I don't like buying clothing. I really don't. I'll buy a shirt here and there, but I still have a shirt somewhere that I wore from when I was running in high school. I have tons of clothes, and by the way, I'm almost 50. I have tons of clothes that I just, keep wearing until, it falls apart, but bought like $400 worth of clothes this week, went to, different places, got a bunch of shirts, got a bunch of shorts, got a bunch of jeans, and it's weird for me. I don't like doing it, but sometimes you just gotta say it's time, and you'll hopefully see a slightly more stylish Tito coming. Cat, you'll see a slightly more stylish Tito coming forward, not that we record yet on live. We will stream. We are planning on live streaming. I have to get the setup done. I have to get some artwork done, and we have to get timing. But we will eventually live stream the podcast. We're just not there yet. But Doc, all this talk of friendship and Disney World and everything, I'm starting to get a little hungry. I think it's almost time for the for an appetizer at least. What do you think?
Yeah, appetizers sound pretty good to me. So obviously this week we're doing a double interview because we have both of you wonderful people here. So the first question is, how'd you get started in gaming in Hearthstone? And this is for both of you.
Okay. For gaming, so let's see, I was 5 years old and my parents bought us for Christmas a Nintendo system. And of course we had like two games. One was the original Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, and the other one was like a Disney based game, which actually is very surprising that there was like, licensed property even back then. But I remember we'd get to certain parts on the Turtles game, and of course my brothers and sisters who are older than me, they'd play it and they'd die horribly because that game is incredibly hard. But then they'd also know that the second stage, which was the hardest one with the swimming turtles, they'd hand me the controller and they'd be like, get Daniel, he can do it. And I'd make it through there every time. So that way they continue to play the rest of the other stages as long as it was their turn to play, right? So that's where I started on gaming. And then I kind of just went with it from there. I think they kind of always realized that I was the go-to person for which video game or board game to play. And, in high school, picked up Magic, and that kind of was my thing for a little bit. And then actually it wasn't until more recently, during like just before the pandemic, I kind of got started on Hearthstone as like my go-to mobile game. And obviously through the pandemic, ended up then kind of graduating into being more involved in it, and to the point where eventually I was streaming it and doing things where I was like, you know what, I really like this one class and no one seems to do it, so I'm going to stream specifically and make content for that because there's no one else doing it. So that's kind of my background story there.
No, long time. For me, it goes way back when my uncle got a pinball machine in the early 70s. I've been kind of gaming my whole life, getting into that pinball first, and then, Pac-Man when the Atari 2600 came out and made it accessible for us, hitting the arcades and things. Really then started hitting board games in the late 90s, especially Magic. Magic then made the transition into the World of Warcraft card game. And honestly, when Hearthstone was announced, then they sucked the license away from Cryptozoic, who was making the Warcraft card game at the time. So I was actually really upset that they were canning my favorite game for Hearthstone. So when the beta came and I got the invite, then I refused to do it. And then was like, all right, I'm going to give it a try when it finally comes out retail. And unfortunately, it means I missed out on the Geblin golden card. So I'll always be one card short because I was stubborn over missing missing my old favorite game. But that's how I got into Hearthstone, and it's just been my game ever since.
Couple notes for each of you. I remember how big a deal it was when Pac-Man came to Atari 2600. That was like the next coming of like, oh my god, everybody, you get to play Pac-Man at home. And we used to be able to clock it. I'm sure you used to clock it, right? So clocking a game back in the day was, there was limited amount of memory in these games. So you could get the high score, you get your score all the way up to like 9999999, and then it was set back to zero, and that was called clocking it. So that was just how games used to work back then. And Noodle, I'm impressed because I remember one thing about Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtle. I don't remember what it was, but there was one part that most people just could not get by. I remember reading in Nintendo Power and they were saying this was hard. I never beat Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles on the Nintendo, so I'm impressed. I'm assuming you beat it and were victorious, so congratulations.
Beating it? No, that game was incredibly hard. But I could get to the later stages. That swimming portion, which was, I think it was like the second stage, it really was like almost a gatekeeper for the whole game as a whole. Like, you couldn't make it to the later stages because you literally only had those four lives of the four turtles. And oftentimes that stage would eliminate half your turtles. So you'd end up being handicapped the rest of the way. There was no way you were going to make it through. So me being the one in my family that could make sure that everybody got through with all four turtles so that way they could continue on was like opening up new worlds and new possibilities.
Now, did you do it with Battletoads as well?
I did play that game too. I don't remember any specifically hard stage on that one though.
The whole thing.
So question for Guy Grumpy, how'd you get started with the Happy Hearthstone podcast?
So that's actually an interesting one. So Andrew Brown was the previous host who had actually taken it over from another host. And as he started to have a family, then he had less and less time. And at the time I was streaming a lot and was kind of getting known for not being so grumpy and kind of being that happy face, especially for smaller streamers and casual streamers, casual players. So he reached out to me when he was at that point where he had to walk away and asked if I would consider taking it over. So we had a little bit of a short transition, but then I was able to kind of take it on unfortunately, you know, take it down a notch, but you know, it's been a great learning experience, and you know, it's my first podcast ever, so it's nice to be trusted with the longest running Hearthstone podcast at that time. So
how long have you been doing it?
3 years now. I want to say it was late 2019.
Oh, pre-COVID. So,
yeah, just before COVID. Yeah.
So, Noodle Swoop, how'd you end up getting to be friends with Guy Grumpy and end up on the podcast?
So, those are two different questions. So, to start off, I was just like most people, I joined into Guy Grumpy's stream. I absolutely love that he did like this thing where he'd play with viewers, especially as the expansion came out. I think back then I wasn't buying into necessarily all the bundles. I was more free to play. And so Guy Grumpy had his full collection. So anytime that a new expansion would come out, he'd open up all the cards and I could work on like decks that I had theory crafted, and he would build them for me so I could play against them as soon as the expansion was out. And that way I had a chance to like get to know, okay, this is what I need to try and find in my collection. This is what I should craft or not craft, right? Like I can go, okay, well, I'll try this like big paladin list. Okay, that's not very good. So let me try a different list. And just a lot of fun, a chance to be able to kind of get to do fun things with cards that I didn't have access to. And that was what I absolutely loved about his stream. And I remember after hanging out for a bit, I think at one point, guy asked me if I was working up my points to get VIP, and I was like, you know what? I don't really want the VIP. I really want that mod sword. To which his immediate response was, here you go. And so that kind of started our friendship, because then I got to see kind of behind the scenes and help him out and do things like mod when he was, you know, on the main page, the splash page for doing the Brawlzeum. And I remember being a mod for that and just being really kind of excited to be part of that. So then we fast forward to where he's now taking over the Happy Hearthstone podcast. And of course, as a avid fan and friend and mod, and then I became a listener of the podcast. And then kind of fast forward a little bit, noticing, you know, kind of the way things were going, I reached out my hand. I said, you know what, we have a really good rapport, and I'm doing this streaming thing now, which he inspired me to do, and I'm kind of doing this content creation thing. I said, why don't I come on and do it with you? I said, our friendship will kind of shine through, and that'll be something that I think your listeners would enjoy.
And at that time, I was really struggling. I had gone through some health problems that was keeping me from being very consistent. And so really, this was an opportunity to kind of enforce that we had somebody backing us up to say, hey, it's been a couple of weeks. We need to get an episode out and try to be a little bit more consistent. We still have issues sometimes from time to time, but really, I've really appreciated Noodle's help in getting that more consistent and keeping it alive, because it might have died otherwise.
Well, I'm glad it's still around, because I wouldn't have the opportunity to meet you two if it wasn't. So this is a dual question. So I guess we kind of already got the answer from Noodle a little bit, but so you both stream. What was the original driving force on starting your streaming careers?
I used to run the fireside gatherings for the Portland area up here in Oregon. We were put together we had a tournament, really. And so when the first tournament that I was involved with came around to the finals, then we decided we wanted to stream it so that people could watch. And so I wasn't the streamer at that time. I was just kind of feeding them the information, running the event and things like that. So, but it was interesting enough to me, the tech and everything that was required, that I really felt like I wanted to get into it. And so after that one, like, I think it was 2 weeks later, then I launched my stream and started to just stream myself playing as a result from that.
And in Guy Grumpy fashion, you started to do this, and now you own all the tech, because that's how you collect things.
Yes, indeed. I have all of the tech, more than I could possibly use. I've got, I think, all of the stream decks. So there's a 6 button, a 15, a 30, and the XL. And it's stupid.
So, sorry, I have a sub question, because I moved to here in Utah from the Pacific Northwest. I lived in Washington State. Just up the road. Did you also do like the ones in Milwaukee?
Yes.
Okay. So I have definitely
I was behind.
Looked at your event page a couple times.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
Pretty cool.
Yeah.
Sorry.
The just... office there in Milwaukee.
All right. What about you, Noodle? What got you I mean, I guess we already got the partial answer, but is there any more of an answer to your jumping off point into streaming?
So the jumping off point, that's definitely with Guy Grumpy. Kind of the whole entire time that I've been talking with him, he knew that I loved Paladin, and in fact I had worked quite a bit on another list that a lot of people know, Labroom Paladin. I actually submitted a viewer deck to Funky Monkey that he then kind of edited and added in, you know, a very specific card that called you a loser, which then ended up becoming very meta as well. So it's kind of two decks that I've had in my history behind me of decks that I've helped to kind of create and go meta. Although I do take pride in definitely the Doomhammer version a little bit more, because that one's a solo creation. So I'll write that down in my record books.
Well, if anybody asks you about the other deck, you can just say it wasn't me.
Yeah. Wasn't me. So definitely. So after I had kind of had that push with that deck, a guy was like, you gotta start streaming. And you know what, at the time it was during the pandemic and, you know, I didn't really have much else to do. I was like, makes sense to me. And, you know, I ended up purchasing my mic and webcam and used my Surface tablet at the time that I had to make a go of it. Now, granted, I pulled back a little bit. I think the last time I went live was a year ago, only because my job currently has kind of caused me to not be able to be consistent. And that's obviously a clear thing for streaming. It does help if you can be consistent. But I'm doing a lot of training. That should hopefully end by the end of the summer. And so I should be able to go back to a little more regular streaming, although it may be not as kind of involved as I was initially, only because obviously my job does require a little bit more of my attention than it did previously when there was like, you know, sit at home and do nothing.
I was going to ask you, because I went to look at some of your streams and it looked like you hadn't streamed in like about like 11 months. So I was curious about what happened there.
That's a lot of it.
I was going to ask you that because I think you haven't streamed that much lately either, but I think it's because you were saying you have some health things. So, got to get yourself right.
Yeah, had to get myself right. I keep trying to come back because it is something I do enjoy when I do it. There's various things that then pull me away, family and other things. So, I'm kind of down to just those release day streams or release week streams where I can open my packs. Everybody can come and get a chance to win some packs and then play against me, like Noodle had said. So with all of the cards, you can build whatever deck and I'll play and let you try it out.
Yeah, I wanted to mention that, actually. Sorry, Doc. One thing I've noticed about your stream, so I popped into your stream for the first time probably a year or two ago. I forget. It's been a while. But I remember you did a giveaway. I was like, oh, I'm here for like a special event. But, like, you streaming seems to be a special event because, like, I think anytime I've ever popped into your stream ever, you're always giving stuff away. Most streamers don't do that. And that is unique to you. So what is the inspiration behind always kind of running giveaways? Because I always tell people, I'm like, why are you not watching Guy Grumpy right now? He is, like, the hidden gem out there, because not only is he a fantastic streamer, a wonderful person, but he's giving away things like all the time. Like, you should have a much you are criminally underfollowed right now, and I like to change that, especially if you come back in. But what's with that?
I don't know. It's just something that I've always kind of like. I find that when I first started, I'm not a legend player like every month. I've made legend before a few times, but I'm kind of, you know, I'm good enough to be Diamond 5 most months and, you know, occasional legend, things like that. So part of it was, hey, when I'm first starting to grow, that's a good way to get people to, you know, come back to your stream. I didn't do it as often as I do now as a percentage of my streams, but that's because I'm streaming a lot less, right? So now I just think it's a lot of fun, and it feels a little guilty when I do a pack opening stream and I'm going to open 400 packs of the golden packs and I'm not giving anything away. Like, that doesn't sound right. Like, I feel like that's the time that you really need to give back to the community. And, you know, it also does encourage people to participate. It gets people, you know, to type something in the chat so that then they feel more comfortable communicating and maybe even then jumping into the queue to play me. And things. So it's really an engagement thing. It's a give back to the community thing. I do love the community. I feel supported and I feel, you know, just lots of love, as you'll always get in my community.
And I have a theory, and it's kind of a dark theory, so I apologize, but I think that you're the reason why esports died, because Blizzard looked and said, well, we can live off Guy Grumpy. We don't need the money that we could possibly generate from esports. So
So as a result of that, I pulled back a little bit. No,
we appreciate that.
It's not really a lot. When you look at the total dollar value, as somebody asked me recently how much I put into the game. I did a video last year when Zeddy and Lieutenant Eddie shared their collections and how much they've spent on it. And, you know, it's not even enough to pay for one person at Blizzard, even when you factor in all the giveaways. So, you know, it's not as bad as it might seem when you're in the stream and you're like questioning, how are is there constantly a giveaway going on this thing?
I just learned something right there. You did a video with Zeddy. That's like balancing the universe between Grumpy and not Grumpy.
Not with Zeddy, but a year ago, then Lieutenant Eddie created a video where he shared how much he did, and then Zeddy followed that up with his own video. And then I was like, if these guys are willing to share, then I should be willing to share as well. And so I kind of copied off of them.
I would like to say, though, I also have heard Guy Grumpy say it before, and I know that it's definitely part of something that he's talked about. I think he does it because he also makes the game more accessible. Like, people will join his stream and gain a few more cards, and then they'll feel like, hey, I didn't have to put out this money, and now I've opened up these packs, and now all of a sudden I can play with these cards, and I can actually play the game of Hearthstone. I think that's part of it, too, because, like, even one of the other things that he's really been working to constantly voice is bringing back the taverns.
The firesides.
Yeah, the firesides. So with that, like, I think that's part of it too. I think he looks at it as he's making the game more accessible for every player. And so I would make sure to voice that because I'm grateful that he's doing that.
Yeah, I think firesides definitely need to come back. There's no reason not to at this point. The only real reason is that the personnel at Blizzard don't have enough time to do everything, but hopefully they're working on it. And if you are out there and you like tavern brawls and you like meeting with people and hanging out and rather instead of playing Friday Night Magic because you don't want to hang out with 14-year-olds, you want to actually play with like adults, reach out to Blizzard on Twitter, say, hey, bring these firesides back because there's no reason to not have now. COVID, it's not over, it's still out there, but we're better with it. We've adapted. So let's get these firesides back. Let's get Guy Grumpy busy again with these firesides.
So we still occasionally will put together a private one, but it's just not publicly available. Which just a quick story on that. And so right before the pandemic hit, that we did a tavern brawl where a guy brought his kid who was just learning to play Hearthstone. He was 11 years old. And then in late 2022, I think it was, then he reached out to me via Twitter and said, hey, I don't know if you remember me, but I met you at a fireside. You hooked me up with some packs and some other things. And I just hit legend for the first time. And I just wanted to say thank you. So it's like, this is a new kid that just got into the game in 2019. So 5 years into the run that's still playing because of the fireside gatherings. So, yeah, you know, more reason. Bring him back.
Yep.
Make them public so that we can get them in.
I have never gone to a fireside, but the idea, especially if you can go to like one that's like at a bar or something like that, and the idea of like hanging out with some buds, new friends, making some new friends, playing Hearthstone, and you know having a couple beers, some chicken wings. Don't get any chicken wing sauce on your screens, but you know, just hanging out, having fun, playing Hearthstone, sharing the joy that we all have. That just sounds like a lot of fun. So I really hope they bring them back. Sorry, Doc, I didn't mean to take us on a tangent.
No, you're good. I'm all for firesides. The only two firesides I've ever gone to were up in Seattle, held by Matadorp or Matthias, depending on how you know him. He doesn't really do anything Hearthstone related anymore, unfortunately. But it was super fun. He held them at a Microsoft store next to the University of Washington campus, and that community was just really inviting. It was like my first in-person Hearthstone events, and I was just scared, nervous little Doc, and Matadorp was super nice individual, made me feel really welcome, and everyone there was just really fun. But yeah, firesides, 12 out of 10. It's unfortunate that they've been gone for so long. So our next question, you both have very unique usernames. Where'd you come up with those, especially Grumpy? Because you seems like you're the antithesis of what Grumpy is.
So when I first started playing Hearthstone, you know, I would fall into the trap of getting really frustrated when my opponent had those huge swing turns that we've all played against and then would get really frustrated with. And, you know, I would get super upset that, hey, this was within my grasp. And then usually it was a priest that either wiped my board or healed up 30 or something like that. And I would just get real like, rrr. And my girlfriend at the time would just then be like, oh, you're so grumpy. And that's just such a silly word, you know, that it would like snap me out of it and be like, yeah, it's just a game. It's just silly. So it's just kind of a reminder that as I started streaming, I don't want to be the person that's angry all the time. So just kind of laugh it off and move on to the next game. It's just a constant reminder.
I'm glad you worked that out before Blood Death Knight came. how about yourself, Doodle?
Oh, I'm back to it now.
So my name actually comes from World of Warcraft. I had played a warrior as like a tank. I was doing kind of the defensive thing and helping bring parties through dungeons and raids and whatnot. But my raiding guild had a like main tank, and I was always like the backup guy. And I was like, you know what? I could just make an alternate character. And at the time, they were like, well, we kind of need a healer. And I was like, fine, I'll make a healer, but you know what? I'll do something I haven't seen. I'll be a druid. And so I created a character and I named him Noon Elsewood, like kind of like as like a, I felt like it was druid, like it's got wood in it, but it's also kind of a joke of like no one else would heal. So therefore Noon Elsewood. I thought it was kind of cheeky, but the hard part is that when you put that all as one word, it's not readable as Noon Elsewood. Instead, it's readable as Noodle Swoop, which is what everybody started calling me, even though the letters didn't, and I tried to fight it, and the more that I fought it, the more it just became ingrained that my name was Noodle Swoop, to the point that I eventually petitioned the GMs and changed my character's name. And by the time I finally got him completely leveled up, we had actually recruited a healer. So then we didn't even need a healer. So I actually became, during Burning Crusade, one of the first raiding Boomkins. And then went on to Wrath of the Lich King and actually was like number two in the world. There was some Korean guy that was doing damage like better than me in some of the raiding guilds. But I was in a hardcore raiding guild for a while. And yeah, it just stuck with me, that name. And even though now I don't necessarily do as much World of Warcraft, I think that's kind of where I got the inspiration to go into Hearthstone. So, I appreciate that, and I continue to carry the name with me.
And now we just call him Nudes.
There you go. I won't ask where that comes from. I'm kind of surprised.
They don't call me that. They call me Noodle.
Well, not. Now they will.
You're welcome.
So I'm surprised that you weren't a paladin in World of Warcraft. I thought that was going to be your origin story. It was like, well, I was a paladin tank, and now I'm a paladin in Hearthstone. I just couldn't let it go. For the light, yes, Uther. So that's a pretty fun story, though. And I was in a raiding guild too, and actually I used to run a raiding guild, and I was always known for not pronouncing things correctly. Like I never knew the names of things, and usually when we had pugs come in or new guildies, like we had somebody named Raps in Chains, they just became Ralph. I butcher people's names and mispronounce their names, and they end up getting new nicknames from that, and it was always something that I enjoyed. It was kind of like the Tito thing, so it was a lot of fun. But anyway, Doc, next question.
Yeah, so Grumpy, you have a wide variety of hats. Is that just a thing you've always collected, just like with everything else?
So I always had a large collection of Hearthstone things. So when I started streaming, I had a pretty good collection of Hearthstone, like ball caps that they would have on the store every now and then. Then when I did my first charity event, then they had you know, some recommendations of things that you could do. I was part of F2K at the time, and they were kind of promoting a few different things. And one of the suggestions they had was a hat swap. So you just swap out your hat. Well, so at first I started just going through the, you know, hats that I had, but then thought, hey, that's actually would be more fun if I had something funny that related to different classes and things like that. So I started adding a few kind of sillier hats. And then, like Tito says, I start collecting something and I go a little bit, you know, a little too far with it. And now I have like 90 hats that ended up in this, you know, crazy selection. Even, you know, you work with Ridiculous Hat, but I think that he'd even mentioned that I have some more Ridiculous Hats than he's even got in his collection. So,
another question for you. You've mentioned it a few times. You have a large amount of dust. Do you know, are you willing to share the number of dust you have?
I actually have it when I do stream. I usually put an image of that. I think I'm at like 1.7 million dust on my button currently. So currently kind of sitting there waiting for me to push it. I'm pulling it up now, and I'll give you an update in just a moment.
To be fair, while he pulls this up, I would like to explain that even though he has the dust button there, there's also the potential of him pushing the dust button that he holds out to all of his viewers as a carrot to say, come back to the stream, and eventually there'll be a stream where I push this button, but it'll never happen.
Well, Crypt did it, and he broke Hearthstone when he had a large amount. It like literally broke the system.
So in talking to the team there, the tech team, it didn't actually break Hearthstone. They had enough advance notice that it just broke the connection to the client and it timed out. And they said that there's a possibility that would happen when I was thinking I was getting close to pushing it in 2020.
And how much dust did you have?
But now I'm just kind of waiting for the time when if I push it, then I'll be able to craft the whole wild set in golden. And I'm pretty close now. So I'm kind of thinking maybe next year on my birthday, 50 years, 10 years of Hearthstone, that'll be a good time to kind of
mark everything. Your calendar, so folks. I'm at, you heard it here.
And I don't know if you guys listen to Squelch 1.8 at all. Million. 1.8 million. If you guys listen to Squelch right now, this is where they'd insert whale noises.
1.8?
This is where they what?
They would insert whale noises bumper.
Right. Oh, yeah. I feel like I'm in the top 100 whales in Hearthstone. Yeah, for sure.
So this one's a little bit more putting both of you on the spot because this is a dual question. But are you willing to share anything that listeners might find surprising to learn about the both of you?
It doesn't have to be serious or like, I think it could be something funny, like I collect lots of weird hats.
Well, I do collect a lot of weird hats. I collect a lot of weird things in general. But nothing I think that would be so shocking. I'll have to think about that for a minute.
It has to be shocking. It might not be something people would know. Right. It's something that people don't know. So, like, I started with an NES. I actually graduated and did not get a Super Nintendo. Instead, I went the Sega route. And so I had Sonic and Knuckles, but I also had all three versions of Sonic the Hedgehog. So Sonic, Sonic 2, and Sonic 3. And I actually fully completed all of that to where you got Golden Knuckles, Golden Tails, and Golden Sonic. Which actually is, it's doable, but it's not something a lot of people know how to do.
Fair enough.
Yeah, that's impressive.
That is impressive. I guess the one that I've been to several BlizzCons, and the first one that I went to, I actually did cosplay as a Murloc, and was in the 30th anniversary book in my costume.
That's really cool.
There's one. That's cool.
I love that.
Yeah, Elkai, you got nothing on Guy Grumpy.
Grumpy, one final question. when did you decide to start your quest for the Golden Wild mini set?
So I started collecting the dust on my button when Krip was collecting his, because I would watch him, and then, you know, he would explain that it really doesn't make sense if you're not going to, if you don't need the dust for anything, you might as well leave it on until they nerf it, and then you can get the higher value of dust. So I just started kind of saving alongside him, and then he gave up because he's like, oh, you'd have to spend so much money on this game that you'll never get to that point. So I was like, all right, well, it's still, I'm still able to buy, you know, what I need right now. I'll just save the dust for when I need it, if I, you know, lose my job and need to, you know, craft an expansion or something like that. And then they started doing the golden packs, which made it reasonable to get the golden sets each new expansion, and that also added a lot more dust. So then it started becoming possible again to say, hey, I will actually be able to someday get this full golden set, because now it's limited by, you know, what there is now. Everything else can be purchased through golden packs. So that just made it all that much more reasonable. And with the collection, the duplicate protection and things like that, then it just, everything starts to align and say, hey, I can actually do this all but one card golden set and wild.
Wonderful.
And I'm hopeful that Hearthstone will have pity on me when I get to that point and say, hey, all right, you can craft that one. And if you could put some pressure on, I'd appreciate that too.
Yeah, for sure. I'll start tweeting at them daily.
Hey, Doc, I don't know about you, but I'm still pretty hungry. I think I'm ready for a little, it's been a long episode already, but I think I'm ready for maybe some main course.
Yeah, sounds good to me, my guy.
All right, so in full disclosure, the way this episode started was a little weird. I was going to have Noodle Swoop on to talk Paladin and mostly the mirror. And our main topic today is the mirror. And then he told me, hey, I'm going to go hang out with my boy Guy Grumpy. And we're like, yeah, that sounds perfect. So we end up doing a joint episode. So we are going to have Noodle Swoop on again in the future. So if you can't get enough Noodle Swoop, he'll be back. We're going to talk Paladin, directly Paladin. But the opportunity to have both Guy and Noodle on here was too good to pass up. So I'm very excited. I'm so glad you were able to do it on such short notice. But today, we're going to talk specifically about the mirror. Now, the reason why it felt topical to talk about the mirror is because, as we were talking about, before the nerfs, Paladin was about 30 to 40% of Diamond 5 to Legend. And so, in order to succeed, you have to understand how to win in the mirror. And that seemed like the perfect time to talk about it. So, Noodle, for our listeners that maybe aren't playing at that level, what is the mirror? When we say the mirror, what are we talking about?
So when you talk about the mirror, you're actually talking about exactly the same deck list. So that's not one card off. That's not a different card. It's the exact same deck list. And oftentimes because that deck has gone meta, right? Everybody knows it. They're pulling it off of HS Replay or maybe off of some streamer's tweet, or, you know, someone that's a deck builder's tweet, and they're all using the same exact thing. And the reason they're doing that is because it's probably one of the best things to do. In fact, I remember Vicious Syndicate came out with a report right after the mini set, and my list was listed as a power level 100 list, which actually means that it's perfect. I've not actually ever seen that happened before on Vicious Syndicate, so I'll just take my kudos for that.
That's a big deal.
With that, it does mean that you're going to see a lot of it, right? So you're going to end up running into somebody playing it. And in fact, what was exciting about making Legend right away was the fact that, like, I was doing it, and I remember, like, at the time I even was working on, like, a not pure version of the same list, and I'd play that and I was like, oh, that's doing terrible. And then I go back to the pure list and I'd be like, oh, this is just so good. And I was like, but I don't want to do it. It just feels too broken. And then I'd go back to the not pure version. And I'd be like, no, I can't do this to myself. And I was like, you know what? Full pedal to the metal. Let's see what I get. And I remember immediately feeling like this is something that is way too good. And I have to let people know about it as quickly as possible. And just made sure to put it out there. So with that, then what was interesting is within not even a day or two, I started to play against other players with my list. And I then also started to see like high level streamers playing the list itself. Like I would go into Theo's stream and he's playing against somebody else at High Legend and it's my list. So really very interesting how that ends up happening. But then it becomes a little bit more of a challenge, right? What do you do to make that edge? How do you end up winning, right?
See, I find it interesting that you say that the it's exact card list, exact list card for card, because I don't really feel the same way in general. Like I would say that if it's the, as long as it's the same archetype, like if you're playing pure paladin, like if I'm playing maybe instead of the I pull out a disco maul and I throw in another tech card because I think that maybe that'll give me advantage. I still feel like that's the mirror versus like if I'm playing big paladin versus outcast paladin big DH versus outcast DH versus relic DH. Like that's not really a mirror even though you're playing the same class. But I think that it doesn't have to be exact card for card. I think as long as it's say like maybe like 25, 26 cards with some tech choices, I think that's still a mirror. Because you never know online or on ladder how close it is. You just kind of have to, like, oh, okay, I see they dropped boogie down on turn three. We're probably playing the same deck, and you can approach it the same way. Would you agree with that?
True, and not. I mean, at the same time, Wu Ling, he's a Chinese deck builder, player, streamer, also put out a list that was similar. But it had still the Muckfin, or Funkfin rather, not Muckfin, Funkfin, and it also had the Seafloor Savior. And that list, I would come up against it, and I would just trounce it. It wasn't even close. So I understand how you would say maybe one or two. But I think as long as it's within two cards difference, then it's the mirror. But other than that, they can oftentimes be different decks and play differently and kind of have a different result. And sometimes that's good too. That would be something I would bring up for the next question.
Yeah, well, so if we're basically running the same deck, how do you get the advantage in the mirror? How do I take my knowledge of this class and this deck, and how do I turn that in my favor over someone playing the same deck? Because that's what we're talking about here, right? That's the real crux here. In a place where we're seeing 30 or 40% of the same deck, I'm going to see it a lot. How do I win that?
So then that's where it becomes really important to have access to tools that will help you out. Running a deck tracker definitely helps you, being able to know what cards you have coming next. But also realizing that then there's other resources for you, like HS Replay, especially the premium membership. You get to the point, and I'm not trying to sell somebody on paying for a premium membership. You don't even have to do that. Sometimes you can just look at the
We've had Andrew is living on the show. We've pimped HS Replay premium before. It's definitely well worth it. You're all good.
But the premium, it gives you then even more insight when it comes to the mirror and how specific cards work in the mirror. But there are also things that you're going to get over time with the feel of it. Like, I know for a fact, Class Action Lawyer, like, she's phenomenal against Paladin. And why? Because Paladin has the Disco Maul, which then means that they're going to end up having a big minion. Well, what helps me beat big minions with the deck that I have? Class Action Lawyer, right? So those things help. Knowing just even the mulligan and making sure that that's on point But that's something that's going to come in even if you're not in the mirror. But even more so, it becomes, okay, well, actually, this card now is more of a priority. Actually, Lady Liadrin is one of those that, believe it or not, Paladin doesn't have a lot of access to rush. So the one thing that helps you reclaim the board is Liadrin, and being able to get her online, that's winning mirrors. And sometimes it's just also realizing that the mirror match really is that 50-50, right? You are at a 50% chance to win. You are at a 50% chance to lose. And sometimes, even if you work really hard at making sure that you mulligan correctly, you play correctly, sometimes you just happen to go second. And that means you're going to lose. And sometimes you happen to go first, and that means you're going to win. And sometimes it's not even that. Sometimes it's just the luck of the draw. You happen to be right on five wooden Pure Raider cost five, and you top deck Pure Raider, and the other opponent doesn't, right? So those, realizing that sometimes it's just not your game to win, and that it's okay to lose the mirror sometimes, is fine. But knowing those things that you can, that will help you, like specifically knowing class action lawyer is a big deal, those can help kind of win those edge cases as well.
And the countess seems to be really important in the mirror as well. Like what you can pull off the countess, really, for me at least in my experience, is if you're playing kind of evenly, like what you get there seems to make a big difference. Although you don't seem to agree.
As I give you my look on the camera to indicate, the countess is a backup plan, especially in the mirror. It's if you get to that point where you're playing the countess, you may have either already lost the game, or maybe that's it actually, because the other player hasn't gotten to the point where they've won yet either. Because oftentimes with the deck, at least in the previous form before the nerfs, you are winning turn 7, turn 8. So if you're playing the countess, you're not winning. Although you might win afterwards, it's not the primary game plan for the deck. So
fair enough. I've just seen it where a lot of times in the mirror we kind of play to a stalemate until that point, and then you know that's where whoever gets to play the countess first seems to get an advantage at that case. But I mean, I'm not playing at D55. I mean, at Ledger 55, so.
Yeah, and that's very much a possibility, right? Like, sometimes it really is, okay, it's my turn 7, and I'm not on the coin, but I was able to play her. But, like, meanwhile, the other player, actually on turn 6, had the coin and played her. But that's also in that, okay, but they didn't actually hook up the weapon, and they don't have all the weapon buffs in hand. They aren't about to just kill you because you don't have any defenses in the way. So it's the backup plan. It's not the primary plan.
So well, I think you talked about this a little bit. I think I know your answer here, but if the mirror is likely, like we said, 30-40%, we're going to see Paladin right now. And that was before the patch. We understand this. But Should I be considering making any changes to my deck, especially given the fact that I'm going to be seeing this matchup? Can I find a way to say, well, no, I'm going to swap out this card for this card and take advantage of the fact that I know the deck that I'm playing and really push there?
So I would say for maybe 90% of players, the answer is no. Because, like you said, it's 40% of your matchups. The other 60% you're winning, right, at that point. But I would also say that there is possibility, right? There are players that are playing at that high level, and there might be other options that maybe give you that edge case and, like, maybe win you the difference. Maybe it's, okay, now that even the nerfs have happened, maybe I take out Muckborn Servant because maybe three mana slot is now very occupied by Boogie Down and Disco Maul. And so maybe instead I put in something in our four mana slot like Jitterbug that helps me get all my combo pieces because I can draw a little bit faster. Again, it's a consideration. But you also have to consider that that also means that that might also weaken your draw off Pure Raider, because Jitterbug's a beast and the Light Rays are elemental beast. So it means you might get one less Light Ray, but maybe you need the draw, so that could be helpful. Again, those are considerations. And like I said, it's one of those things of, unless you really look at the stats and you really understand where your weak cards are, or where the weak point is in your matchup, messing with the deck can sometimes not actually be helpful and might actually just break it.
No, see, like, I would probably take out a Muckburn in this case, and if, well, it's pure, so it's hard, but otherwise I would consider throwing in maybe ETC. I'm just kidding. I love the pick going back and forth. I've been throwing that in decks even where it doesn't belong, just because it adds attention that doesn't belong there. But no, so that makes sense. And plus, we're talking about a deck here, like, that you said it has a 100% rating on Vicious Syndicate or whatever. So there's probably not much tinkering there. And there's probably other places where, like, I think a lot of places where you see a lot more tinkering is something like a Miracle Rogue, where there's so much kind of different things you can do with that, that throwing in a different card might be interesting. So maybe not necessarily in the pure Paladin matchup here, because you're actually very limited with what you can do, given the fact that it is pure Paladin. You can't pull from a lot of things. But yeah, a lot of times when I see a lot of the same deck over and over again, that is a mirror match, I do try to, well, how can I get this to my advantage? What could I possibly throw in there? Like, is it worth throwing in a Viper if I'm playing against a certain class or stuff like that? So sometimes just to try to find that little edge that gets you that 55% against that particular class, as long as it doesn't hurt you against the other classes, could be fun, could be interesting.
And I completely agree with that. If we were talking with Wicked Good, and we were talking about the mirror for Priest, it would be a totally different subject, because there are some times where those choices are very different, and that it changes that mirror immensely and makes it potentially something where you're like, okay, it's riskier. I maybe lose a different matchup, but I only see them maybe 10% of the time. And then meanwhile, I'm now winning this mirror matchup. But I would leave that to the Priest mains to talk about, not for me to talk about which choices are the best choices there.
To be fair, if we were talking to Wicked Good, we'd still be waiting for him to start the show to finish up the Priest mirror he was in the middle of before the show was about to start.
So he hit the turn limit timer. I don't know what to tell you.
I've seen it on his stream. So a lot of folks don't like playing a mirror, like, especially like, so so funny story, actually I should have mentioned this at the top. So funny story, this week I am part of Team Hype Horizon, and they do a tournament every month called TNT. They do a tournament called TNT that every month it's just like a little mini tournament. And I was watching the feed, and you on a team, you try not to counter stream versus like something that maybe the team's doing. But I didn't want to run like a little side event, and I wanted to stream for a little while. So I just pulled up their feed and I started casting on my own stream, still promoting the brand. And their main feed went down. So I went from, hey, I'm going to go to bed in a few minutes, to, okay, now I'm casting the event. Because they switched over to me because I was doing it. And it got to be almost midnight, and I'm like, okay, one match left. And I'm like, this is fine. And it was blood versus blood, DK. So 45 minutes later, I finally was able to go to bed.
I think you just turn it off and say, we'll fill you in on the winner tomorrow.
It was a thought, but so a lot of people don't like playing the mirrors because it's like it feels like it's a different matchup than most Hearthstone games, because it's like a chess match. It's like chess, right? Because Hearthstone right now, you have different pieces on the side of the board, but like chess, going first, going second, is like black versus white. There is a literal kind of parallel with chess more so than anything else. So do you find it as like the most skill intensive matchup for a deck to play against itself?
Yes. And in fact, that was one of the biggest things for me, especially now that I'm currently in, you know, top 500, and at points I was even higher than that legend. Every game to me was very intense, and to the point of, I would only play it on my computer and I would take my whole turn timer. And that's okay. Like, if that is what you want to do, then do it. like take that time, be able to make those decisions wisely, think about what's the next thing. But the biggest thing is it's the mirror too. So you know what else they have in their deck, right? So you can plan those turns out and you can think about, okay, maybe I do hold this card back, or maybe I don't do this next step. But then you also know what the potential is if they get the thing that they get. And sometimes you just ultimately have to say, well, they got to have it. I'm going to go ahead and push and make those choices. But just realize sometimes it's just, even if you do all the right choices, it, again, it's a 50-50. There were points when I was playing the mirror where I was like, all right, they won. But in the end, I still feel successful because what did they win with? They won with my deck.
So you don't regret putting it out there for everyone to copy? You could be number one legend.
They'd still figure it out. Someone would eventually find me and be like, they'd watch, they'd see me play against enough people and they'd figure out what's today. I'm sure.
Yeah, the so I actually, when I played a lot, I played a lot of Shadow Priest a couple months ago when it was kind of big. I actually started playing with it before it was big, and because I knew that the patch was coming up, and listening to the VS report, they're like, oh, Shadow's going to be really good. So I started playing Shadow right before that to really figure it out, and I played probably 1,000 games with the deck. So, like, even against the mirror, I felt like I had an advantage because I'm like, I know how your deck works. So, like, I know what you're doing. I know what I'm going to do. Boom, done. Like, go ahead, bring it. What are you going to show me that I haven't seen? But what would you say some of the most common mistakes people make in the mirror?
I think that's a lot of it too, right? Because I built the deck, I'm able to make that good choice. I think a lot of common mistakes for that mirror is oftentimes mistaking the fact of playing the Class Action Lawyer out as tempo, without realizing what they have, what they're facing. I mean, oftentimes it's, you need to also take into consideration what they've played. Have they gotten a one mana minion down? Have they played Boogie down? Is it the 3 mana turn or is it the 4 mana turn? Knowing those things and seeing the way that the game is progressing, sometimes it is the correct choice to tempo it out, but oftentimes it is not. because of the fact that, like, the weapon, the Disco Maul does exist, and also you have the potential for even bigger minions potentially countess down the way. There are other ways to kind of get there. So understanding that is important, and even understanding mulligan is important. I think that oftentimes can be an issue.
I think one of the biggest issues with the deck, if I may interject, I think is that people don't know, don't swing enough with the Maul. A lot of times people will hold that final swing to tempo to create maybe. So, and I do the same thing too, is like, well, I'm not going to swing here because if they clear my board, then I don't have that attack, and I'd rather swing and then attack with something right away to get that damage. But if you don't swing, then maybe it's a lot harder for them to clear the board. If you do swing, so you get a bigger minion. Like, what do you think about that?
Oh, that's true, but not true in the mirror. So, like, knowing the classes that you're up against when it comes to, like, other classes, knowing, like, that Demon Hunter actually doesn't have a great ability to clear big minions, that's really key. Like, those are those times where I would break the weapon faster. But in the mirror, it actually is probably, I'd say, 70% of the time, the correct answer is actually to hold it. Just so that way you can get that damage to go phase. Yeah.
Fair enough. All right. So, you have any final thoughts for our listeners on the mirror match?
I would ask, Irumpy, have you faced any mirror matches, and do you have any input on mirror matches?
So mirror matches for me are much different, especially since I've been kind of maining the duels area. So the passives that you get drastically change what those matchups are. So I don't have nearly the experience that you would have on mirror matches in general. I will say that when you see them on tournaments, then they are not the most exciting ones to see cast or to watch. It's obviously more intense, and people do take longer on the turns. But yeah, I don't have enough experience to say, you know, whether it's all deserved, the rating that they get.
Well, you heard it here first. Guy Grumpy does not want specialists to come back. But anyway, Doc, I don't know. But, oh, I'm sorry, Doc. Do you have any final thoughts on the mirror?
Yeah, don't break it, because then that's bad luck.
Fair enough. Well, Doc, on that note, I'm getting kind of full, but as always, I think there's a little room for dessert. What do you think?
Yeah, dessert sounds pretty good. So, listeners, as we say every week, please leave us a review, email us, positive, negative of what you feel about the show, so that way we can improve the show to make it the show that we want it to be and something that's enjoyable for you to listen to. And it helps us out. So we would appreciate a 5-star review, but honestly, give us an honest review. If you don't feel like it's 5 stars, don't give us 5 stars, but it helps with visibility. So that's why we ask for it. So one final question for the both of you. What is your favorite dessert?
So I have to say, actually, our favorite dessert is, to give you guys a card of the week, actually, is by far my favorite dessert. It is the way that we end out our Happy Hearthstone podcast. And so we actually wanted to provide you with the dessert today.
Okay.
It's the crossover.
Mm-hmm.
Makes the podcast like we got taken over.
Mm-hmm.
Popping our mics, baby, with no do-overs.
Mm-hmm.
Puffing a bit of clover. Gonna need to do some voiceovers. Gotta sing our song slower.
Believe it. We ain't got no plans to stay here. We just came so we can play here. We're gonna record this weekend.
Oh, you know. It's the crossover.
Mm-hmm.
Drop a few bars like a podcasting composer.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe gain us all a little bit more exposure.
Mm-hmm.
What a fortunate thing this summer.
Recording on bread and butter. Tell me, did we just stutter? It's a crossover.
Mm-hmm.
Drop a few bars like a podcasting composer.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe gain us all a little bit more exposure.
Mm-hmm.
What a fortunate thing this summer. Recording on bread and butter. Tell me, did we just stutter? It's a crossover. It's the crossover.
Y'all, 12 out of 10. That was so great. Thank you so much.
It's supposed to be sweet. It's the dessert.
I loved that. I wish we were recording, because I was just awestruck the whole time. Well, I know we're audibly recording, but I wish there was video just to see, like, I don't know. It was great. I loved it. Thank you so much.
So not tiramisu. No, that was fantastic, guys. That was great.
Actually, it's key lime pie.
I have to go with cookies. I don't know. I'm pretty simple that way.
Hey, cookies are good.
That was well done. So they told Noodle said we have a surprise for you at the end of the show, and there it was. Very good, guys. That was awesome.
Yeah. Thanks so much. So as we do every week, we ask our guests, if people want to find you, where can they find you?
So I mainly on Twitter at NoodleSwoop, and I also on Twitch at NoodleSwoopHS.
And I can be found on Twitter, Twitch, and TikTok as Guy Grumpy. And we are also found on Twitter at The Happy HS, and you can go to the Happy Hearthstone or at Patreon or happyhearthstone.patreon.com for the Happy Hearthstone content.
And where can people go to find more of your acapella work?
Well, the Happy Hearthstone.
Clearly listen to the podcast, because there's several of those to listen through, actually.
Maybe they'll go on TikTok at some point,
our
too.
Our last episode had 3 of them.
Yeah, that's true.
Okay, I got homework. that's what I'm getting from this.
All right, Doc, where can people find you?
Yeah, you can find me at Twitter and Twitch at Doc McButt. And Tito? And
you can find me at Twitter and Twitch at Tito Santana HH, HS, excuse me, Noodle. Any shout outs this week?
So I think I'm gonna go back to shouting out Clark Hellscream. I think he was definitely part of the whole experience on getting my deck list out to everybody. I mean, I'm definitely still, I have people that follow me, but not nearly the level that he does. He put out the tweet that was for all the mini set decks that got all the traction. So I have to do my shout out for Clark Hellscream.
He also banned all your good cards in his tournament this weekend.
So, yeah, I saw that too. Yes.
How about yourself, Guy? Where can people find you?
All right, for shout out.
I'm sorry, shout out.
I'll shout out the Hearthstone community team again, asking for the fireside gatherings to come back. So Alkali Lake, Ridiculous Hat, please make that happen. Also, we'll shout out Celestalon just to see if he'll be kind and give me the Gelbin golden opportunity. So thank you all in advance. You're wonderful people, and we love you.
I love that. I love that. I got bad news for you. I don't think they listen. Doc, where can they find you? What any shout outs this week for you?
Yeah. So my shout out is going to go to Daniel Sturmer Sheldon. So over at Blizzlet, they started the Video Game of the Month Club, which they roll a dice on I think it's 1 to 7, the next dice roll, to see which video game that everyone who wants to participate can purchase or download if it's free and play it. And then at the end of the month, we all have like a round table, we'll sit and talk about the game. Daniel was the first one to beat the game that was my suggestion, which was Plague Tale Innocence, which is a fantastic game. It's mainly a story-driven game with some puzzles in there. It's not too mechanically intensive, but it's just a good game. And he was the first one to announce that he has beaten it in their server. So I just want to give a shout-out to Daniel for playing the game. Tito, how about yourself?
I'm on Chapter 7. I played once. At least this is a game we can actually play on stream. It's been fun. It's not usually my style of game. I don't play a lot of the sneaky round kind of puzzler type things. Not that I don't like them. It's just I tend to play Hearthstone and Warcraft, and those take up a lot of time. Those are lifestyle games and Civ. So I don't do it, but I'm playing it this time. It's fun. We'll try. I don't know if I'll finish it by the end of the month, but I do plan on finishing it. So we'll see how it goes, mostly because I'm on vacation next week. But I'd like to shout out Ridiculous Hat for the recommendation of Noodle Swoop, which brought us to Guy Grump, who I was already familiar with. So Hat's basically our booker right now. I say, hey, Hat, I have this idea for a topic. And he said, I say, who can I bring on? He's immediately like, this guy. I was like, great. Or this girl. Or whoever. So it is fantastic. And I want to definitely shout out the Happy Hearthstone, who's about to hit 250 episodes. That's just fantastic. I can't wait to hear the episode. But anyway, Doc, I think that's about it. I think we're toast.
Noodle.
Noodle, what's up?
So I would also like to say, Hat reached out to me as to like make sure that we got the connection for the show. And he even made it a point to give me a happy birthday on my birthday. So he is just
heck yeah,
stellar of a person. That's amazing. I can't appreciate that he's now part of the team even more so. So it's just great all around that he's where he's at.
I had to ask him the other day. I said they had the episode of, oh, I'm sorry, we should also shout out Coin Concede, who hit 400 episodes just recently. But I said, they wanted to have Hat on for the 100th episode, but apparently they couldn't make it work at this time. I was like, how weird was it for someone to ask you to be on a podcast and you had to say, I can't do it, sorry. that's a new thing for him. But, Doc, you had one more thing?
I do really quick want to thank the both of you for taking the time out of your time together to spend time with us. It's been a pleasure to have you on, and I'm so glad that I've got to meet people behind the Twitter usernames. But yeah, it's been fantastic. Thank you guys so much.
Yeah, we're looking forward to seeing you at BlizzCon. So,
and thanks for having us on.
It's appreciated. But I think we're toast, guys. We'll see you later.
See ya.
Slide two brothers meet one another when they slide up to the mic. It's bread and butter with one another. Let's start up that recording light.